Welcome to Eye Care Central. This video is on pupillary light reflex. In this video, we will discuss the pupillary light reflex pathway in detail and we will also learn how to determine the site of lesion in cases of abnormal pupillary reflex. So we will start with the very basics. This is the diagram of the eye. This circular brown structure is the iris and this round gap in the center of the iris is known as the pupil. The normal size of the pupil ranges from 3 to 5 mm in diameter. Light enters our eye through the pupil. Now, when bright light is shown on the pupil responds by decreasing in size. This is known as constriction of the pupil, and this constriction of the pupil in response to light stimulus is known as pupillary light reflex. Pupillary light reflex can be a direct light reflex, or it can be an indirect light reflex, which is also known as consensual light reflex. Direct light reflex is when constriction of the pupil is seen in response to light shown in the same eye, that is the ipsilateral eye. For example, if this is the right eye of the patient and we shine light on this right eye and in response we see the pupil of the right eye constricting, it is known as direct light reflex, because the response is occurring in the same eye that is receiving the stimulus. The other reflex is the consensual light reflex. Consensual light reflex is when the light stimulus is given to one eye, but the response to that stimulus is seen in the opposite eye, that is the contralateral eye. So again, in this patient, when we show light in the right eye, we will see constriction of pupil in the opposite eye, that is the left eye. So this constriction of pupil that occurs in response to light stimulus given in the contralateral eye is known as consensual light reflex. Both of these responses, that is the direct light reflex as well as the consensual light reflex, they occur simultaneously, that is they occur together at the same time. So if we shine light in the right eye, we will see both pupils constricting together, which means that the right eye will show direct light reflex and the left eye will show consensual light reflex, and both of these reflexes are seen in response to the same light stimulus that was given in the right eye. So how do you perform pupillary light reflex test? First of all, it should be done in a semi-dark room. Semi-dark so that you are able to observe the response in the contralateral eye. So we ask the patient to fixate on a distant object. Why? Because if the patient fixates on a near object, the near reflex pathway will get activated, which will cause pupillary constriction. So we want to eliminate any cause of pupillary constriction when we are checking the pupillary light reflex pathway. So first we observe the position, size and shape of the pupil in each eye. Then we shine the torch in one eye and we observe the response of the pupil in the same eye. This is the direct light reflex. Then again we shine light in the same eye, but this time we observe the response in the opposite eye. That is the contralateral eye, and this is the consensual light reflex. And then we repeat the procedure on the other side to check the direct and the consensual light reflex to light stimulus given on the opposite side. Before proceeding further, we need to be absolutely clear about certain terminologies. Suppose in a patient, light is shown in the left eye and both pupils constrict. We document it as left direct light reflex present and right consensual light reflex present. So the nomenclature is with respect to the eye which is responding to the stimulus and not with respect to the eye which is receiving the stimulus. Suppose in a patient's case sheet it is written that right direct light reflex and right consensual light reflex is present. It means that the right eye constricts to light stimulus given to the right eye, which is the direct reflex, and it also constricts to the light stimulus given in the left eye, which is the consensual reflex. So right consensual reflex does not mean that light stimulus is given in the right eye. It means that the pupillary response to light stimulus is seen in the right eye. I hope this is clear for you now. Now the stroma of the iris has two muscles, the sphincter pupillae and the dilator pupillae. Sphincter pupillae muscle is circularly arranged at the border of the pupil. So when the sphincter pupillae muscle contracts, it leads to constriction of the pupil, and this occurs via the parasympathetic pathway. This constriction of the pupil is known as meiosis. The dilator pupillae muscle is inserted at the root of the iris and from there it extends radially to about 2 mm from the margin of the pupil. So the dilator pupillary muscle gets activated by the dark reflex pathway, which is a sympathetic pathway, and this results in dilatation of the pupil, and dilatation of the pupil is known as midriasis. Now the diameter of the pupil is the result of the balance between these two antagonistic muscles, that is the sphincter pupillae and the dilator pupillae of the iris. Since in this video we are talking about the light reflex pathway, we will be restricting ourselves to only the parasympathetic pathway that results in constriction of the pupil via the sphincter pupillae muscle. So pupillary light reflex pathway is a parasympathetic pathway with an afferent limb and an efferent limb. Afferent limb means that sensory stimulus is carried to the brain via this route. Efferent limb means that this route carries signals from the brain to the effector organ, that is the sphincter pupillary muscle in this case. As we all know, light enters the eye through the pupil. Then it falls on the retina of the eye. From the retinal ganglion cells, the information is carried by the optic nerve. Optic nerve is the second cranial nerve. Optic nerve carries impulses from the nasal half of the retina and the temporal half of the retina. So the fibers here that are arranged laterally represent the temporal fibers, and the fibers that are present medially represent the nasal fibers. Then the optic nerve reaches the optic chiasma. Optic chiasma is located just above the pituitary gland. At the optic chiasma, decussation of these nerve fibers takes place. Now, what is the meaning of decussation? Decussation means that the nerve fibers from one side cross over to the opposite side. So, the fibers that were carrying signals from the nasal half of the retina on the right side cross over to the left side. But the fibers that were carrying signals from the temporal half of the retina do not cross. They continue to travel along the same side, that is along the right side. It is seen that the ratio of crossed to uncrossed fibers is approximately 53:47, which means that more fibers cross over than those that stay on the same side. This decussation occurs on both the sides. So nasal fibers of the right eye cross over to the left side, and then they continue with the temporal fibers of the left eye, while the nasal fibers of the left eye cross over to the right side, and then they continue with the temporal fibers of the right eye. They continue as optic tracts. Thus, each optic tract contains ipsilateral temporal fibers and contralateral nasal fibers. Now, the pathway that we are discussing here is the pupillary light reflex pathway, but we also know that it is the same optic nerve that carries signals to the occipital cortex of the brain via the visual pathway. And this is how image processing takes place and we are able to see things. This means that the optic nerve carries afferents for vision as well as for pupillary constriction. Now, how are these two pathways separate from each other? So, most of the nerve fibers that are carried by the optic tracts synapse in the lateral geniculate body. Lateral geniculate body is located in the thalamus, and from the lateral geniculate body, the signals are carried to the visual center, which is located in the occipital lobe of the brain. So, this is the visual pathway in brief. However, a small number of these fibers, they do not go to the lateral geniculate body. They exit from the optic tract, and instead of going to the lateral geniculate body, they go to the pretectal nucleus. Pretectal nucleus is located in the midbrain at the level of the superior colliculus. So it is these fibers that go to the pretectal nucleus instead of the lateral geniculate body that are responsible for the pupillary light reflex. Each pretectal nucleus is connected to Edinger-Westphal nucleus that is also located in the midbrain. This connection occurs via neurons that are known as internuncial neurons. Edinger-Westphal nucleus is an accessory nucleus of the main oculomotor nerve or the third cranial nerve. These are paired nuclei, which means that there is a right Edinger-Westphal nucleus and a left Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Edinger-Westphal nucleus is located posterior to the main motor nucleus of the oculomotor nerve in the midbrain. It is a parasympathetic nucleus, and fibers arising from Edinger-Westphal nucleus eventually innervate the sphincter pupillae and the ciliary muscle of the eye. What is extremely important to understand here is that each pretectal nucleus is connected to both the Edinger-Westphal nuclei. So the right pretectal nucleus is not only connected to the right Edinger-Westphal nucleus, but also to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus on the left side. Similarly, the left pretectal nucleus is connected to the left as well as the right Edinger-Westphal nucleus. This explains consensual light reflex because stimulation of pretectal nucleus leads to the activation of both Edinger-Westphal nuclei. Preganglionic parasympathetic fibers arise from the Edinger-Westphal nucleus and then they are carried by the oculomotor nerve. At about the level of the superior orbital fissure, the oculomotor nerve divides into a superior division and an inferior division. The parasympathetic fibers travel in the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve to reach the ciliary ganglion where they synapse. Ciliary ganglion is located about 1.5 to 2 cm behind the eyeball, embedded in the fat surrounding the eyeball. From the ciliary ganglion, postganglionic fibers arise that travel via the short ciliary nerves which perforate the posterior sclera. So there are about 5 to 15 short ciliary nerves that perforate the posterior sclera. Then they continue in the suprachoroidal space and ultimately reach the pupil to stimulate the sphincter pupillae muscle and the pupillary constriction takes place. So this completes the pupillary light reflex pathway. So the pupillary light reflex has an afferent limb. The afferent limb runs within the optic nerve or the second cranial nerve and the efferent limb runs along the oculomotor nerve or the third cranial nerve. So we will summarize the pathway. Light stimulates the retinal ganglion cells, then the impulse is carried by the optic nerve. Decussation of nerve fibers occurs at the optic chiasma. Then the temporal fibers travel in the right optic tract and the nasal fibers travel in the left optic tract. They reach the pretectal nucleus. Pretectal nucleus activates both the Edinger-Westphal nuclei. Preganglionic fibers arising from Edinger-Westphal nuclei are carried by the respective third cranial nerve. These fibers synapse in the ciliary ganglion and then postganglionic fibers are carried to the sphincter pupillae muscle by the short ciliary nerves. Thus, impulse received by one eye causes constriction of pupil in both the eyes. So this is what explains the consensual light reflex. Because although each Edinger-Westphal nucleus is responsible for ipsilateral pupillary constriction, but since both of them get stimulated together because of their connection with the pretectal nucleus, this allows bilateral pupillary constriction to take place. Now let's see what happens in different nerve lesions, but before that we need to know what happens in a normal case. So in a normal case, when the afferent and the efferent pathways in both the eyes are intact, what do we see? So when we shine light in the right eye, direct light reflex is seen in the right eye and consensual light reflex is seen in the left eye. And when we shine light in the left eye, direct light reflex is seen in the left eye and consensual light reflex is seen in the right eye. Now suppose if we shine light on the right eye, the pupil of both the eyes constrict. But when we shine light in the left eye, no response is seen in either eye. What does this mean? So if we shine light on the right eye, and the pupil of the right eye constricts, it means that this is the direct light reflex. So if direct light reflex is seen in the right eye, it means that its afferent as well as efferent are working fine. Constriction in the left eye means that the left eye is responding to the light stimulus given in the right eye, which again confirms that impulse received by the right eye is causing a response in the left eye. So this consensual arc is also intact. That means that the right afferent and the left efferent are working fine. Now, if we shine light in the left eye, no response is seen in either eye. This means that both the left direct light reflex as well as the right consensual light reflex are absent. This means that impulse received by the left eye is not reaching either the left eye or the right eye. And what is common between the two? The left afferent. So this is a case of a left optic nerve defect. Now suppose the left direct light reflex is absent and the right consensual light reflex is present and right direct light reflex is present but left consensual light reflex is absent. Where does the defect lie in this case? So here, since the left direct light reflex is absent, it means that either the left afferent or the left efferent is defective. And since right consensual reflex is present, It means that the afferent of the left eye and the efferent of the right eye are working fine. Now, if we check the reflexes in the other eye, the right direct light reflex is present. What does that mean? This means that the right afferent as well as the right efferent are fine. If left consensual is absent, that means that there is a problem in either the right afferent or the left efferent. Now, since we know that the right direct light reflex is present, the right afferent is working fine. So that leaves us with the left efferent. So here the defect lies in the left oculomotor nerve. Because if the left oculomotor nerve is damaged, the impulses from the left eye and the right eye, they will reach the higher centers via the afferents. But the parasympathetic response generated in the Edinger-Westphal nucleus will not reach the sphincter pupillate to bring about either the direct light reflex or the consensual light reflex because the third nerve is damaged. The reason why pupillary light reflex occurs is because it helps in regulating the amount of light that enters the eye. This in turn protects the cells of the retina, particularly the photoreceptors, that is the rods and the cones, from light-induced damage. Pupillary light reflex also helps in improving the quality of vision because too much brightness can affect contrast and induce aberrations. Clinical significance of pupillary light reflex: it is a useful diagnostic tool for testing the integrity of the sensory and the motor functions of the eye. That is the integrity of the retina, the integrity of the optic nerve, the integrity of the oculomotor nerve, etc. Emergency physicians often perform pupillary light reflex tests to assess brainstem function, including cases of brainstem death where both the direct as well as the consensual light reflexes are absent in both the eyes. In the next video, we will discuss the sympathetic innervation of pupil that causes pupillary dilatation via the dark reflex pathway. Until then, please like and share this video with your friends and colleagues if you found it useful, and please subscribe to my channel to support free education. Thank you very much.